The main thing to understand about the late 19th century is this increasing antagonism between Chinese nationalism, which was of course influenced by Japan and the West, since it was a period of nationalism and new nations and sense of nationhood and so on, which hadn't really existed very much before, and this increasingly antiquated, rigid, conservative, backward in many ways in its time, Manchu dynasty. The Qing dynasty was, of course, a dynasty that consisted of Manchus and not Han Chinese. And so there was more and more resistance against being ruled by foreigners in China. The idea of ethnic difference is, of course, a rather new notion. In the past, the idea of being Chinese did not necessarily depend on ethnicity. But ethnic nationalism was really another import from the West. It started in Europe, this idea that nationhood and ethnicity somehow were the same thing. And the Chinese and the Japanese and others in East Asia took this notion over. And the Manchus were not only ethnically different from the Han Chinese, the mainstream Chinese, but they had their own language and their own culture and so on. And of course, the Manchu elite, the aristocrats, the emperors, and so on, were to a large extent Sinified and prided themselves on their mastery of Chinese calligraphy and the Chinese classics and Chinese painting, because that was in China, even when China was ruled by a foreign dynasty, Mongols, Manchus, and others, was the sign of civilization. So they adopted these things, but amongst themselves, in the court, they still often use Manchu, and many things that we now think of as sort of typically Chinese were really imposed by the Manchus. And so they were seen by Chinese nationalists, Han Chinese nationalists, as foreign rulers. The young intellectuals in China, influenced by Japan, which was in turn influenced by the West, wanted to reform the increasingly antique institutions, political institutions of China. They had a short chance to do so. Intellectuals such as Kang Youwei, they were backed in the beginning by important members of the Manchu dynasty. There was a reformist emperor before the last emperor in the late 18th century, Jiang Xu, who was very much a backer of the young reformist intellectuals. And he was deposed by Zhu Xi. The Empress Dowager Zhu Xi was a formidable figure, known as the Old Buddha, who ruled with an iron hand, one of the great exceptions to the usual situation in world history where men are the great dictators or the great tyrants. In this case, it was a woman. She was by nature very conservative, but also deft enough to see which way the wind was blowing, except that she sometimes called it wrong. She did allow the reformists in the late 19th century to try and instigate reforms for a while and then crack down. What she then did is she saw resistance against foreigners, meaning not Manchus but Westerners, missionaries, merchants and others who were having an increasing influence and power in China. And that was expressed in the so-called Boxer Rebellion in 1900. And she decided to back these Boxers, who were groups of martial arts figures and so on, and with a nationalist anti-Western agenda. And she backed them. And that ended in a disaster, of course, because once they'd got to Beijing, and the foreign legations in Beijing were under siege by the Boxers, the foreign armies decided to step in, and the Japanese and the Germans and the Americans and the British and so on basically ganged up together to crush this rebellion. And then again, she saw that some very quick footwork was necessary to escape the crackdown by foreign armies herself, and turned against the Boxers. But it made her very unpopular. More modern forms and institutions were growing around them, including military ones. So you had warlords and others who imported modern technology, had foreign advisors, and were quite sophisticated in a military sense, while the Manchu armies, the bannermen, were stuck in an earlier age and were in no position really to defend the dynasty when things got rough.
No, take it off.
No, and you're not the emperor anymore. There is a new emperor now. He has cut off his queue, and instead of a camel, he has got a car.
The main reason for the revolt in 1911, the revolution, was really the surge of nationalism in China, and which was both modernizing and nationalist in the sense of wanting to get rid of the foreign dynasty. One key figure in the revolution in 1911 is, of course, Sun Yat-sen. And Sun Yat-sen comes from the south of China, from a little village near Canton. But actually the revolution was hatched not inside China, but abroad, in Hawaii, in Japan, and other places. And this is has often been the case in China, where new dynasties, when old dynasties crumbled and new dynasties came in, they often came from outside the Chinese borders, either led by more vigorous foreign troops, it could be Mongols or Manchus or whatever, or in this case, overseas Chinese. And so Sun Yat-sen, was a student in Japan, lived in Hawaii, spent time in London and so on, was very much part of this sort of diaspora of Chinese activists, intellectuals who wanted to modernize China. He was very much a man of his time in that he had adopted all kinds of westernized ideals of democratic rule and tried to adapt it to a country which, of course, didn't have that tradition at all, came from a very different tradition. And so there's a lot of ambiguity in the kind of political institutions he helped to institute. And he's chiefly known for his slogan of the three... I don't quite know how to translate it, but the three principles of the people. And one was nationalism, and one was socialism, and one was the rights of the people. And the nationalism was still a holdover, really, of the anti-Manchu Han Chinese chauvinism. And I think what he wanted was genuinely to have some kind of modern democratic republic. The other figure, who also was influenced by Japan and also spent time there in a military academy, was Chiang Kai-shek, who did not come from the south but came from Zhejiang, a little bit north of Shanghai, and was the sort of military arm of the revolution, if you like, the Young Turk, whereas Sun Yat-sen was more the political activist. One of the problems, I think, when empires come to an end and a new form of government has to be formed, is one of legitimacy. The imperial rulers, the emperors, even if they had been peasants at birth, once they became emperor, they had the imprimatur of heaven. They had the so-called mandate of heaven, which was a religious idea. So their legitimacy was really because the gods above had given them the right to rule. Now, when you take away that system, you don't only take away political institutions, you take away a whole idea of political legitimacy, which was, in essence, a religious one. So you have to find something to take its place. Now, elections, of course, in modern democracies are the way that we now give our ruler's legitimacy. But this was had not really yet been tested in China, and after a first very small beginning was strangled because it was really taken over very quickly by military strongmen. So I think the problem was that it wasn't ever quite clear who was in charge and who had the legitimacy to be in charge. And that's why Yuan Shikai, this warlord general who had at one point been one of the Empress Dowager's generals during the empire, was persuaded to crown himself as a kind of monarch again, because it was, in effect, it was a way to find, to use the past and to use the sort of monarchical institution to give himself the legitimacy to be China's strongman. Sun Yat-sen never really had that kind of aura, and nor did any of the other civilian politicians. And because nobody really could claim the legitimacy of their rule over the whole of China, it very quickly fell apart in squabbling regional factions and warlords.
The rotten government of the Republic is in flight. Now we shall remove the foreign stench of the Manchurian rats who still hide in a forbidden city.
The so-called warlord period was a disastrous period for the Chinese, and by no means the first one that they've had in their history. There have been other periods of chaos and disorder when empires came to an end, and it wasn't quite clear who was going to get the mandate of heaven, as it were, to rule China again in this vacuum. China would always fall apart, and power went to whoever had the clout in their different regions to wield it, the military clout, that is. And so the warlord period was really nothing new in China. And so you had various warlords. You had a Christian warlord in the north, and you had Yuan Shikai, and you had many others. In Manchuria, you had Japanese-backed warlords, and they all had their fiefdoms. And as long as there was no central power, these were really the only players, and they were brutal. Charisma and military power was really all they had as a form of legitimacy, which was not very legitimate at all. A very important date in that period is 1919. The end of World War I, in which the Japanese at the very last moment took the side of the Allies, turned into a kind of humiliation for the Chinese. And out of this came an intellectual cultural movement, to begin with, called the May 4th Movement of 1919. So it was intensely important, and something that began as a student demonstration that was cultural, nationalist, became in time more and more political. What happened was that students, mostly of Beijing University, Beida, went into the streets and demonstrated against the Treaty of Versailles, which allowed the Japanese to get the German concessions. So it was a nationalist protest against weak Chinese government of a kind that we've seen many times since, I mean, including in very recent times. And at the same time, it was a modernizing revolutionary force. It was showed an impatience with the process of modernization of China.
They were protesting against the Republican government because it has agreed to give away Chinese territory to Japan.
Is it true, Mr. Johnston, that many people out there have had their heads chopped off?
It is true, Your Majesty. Many heads have been chopped off. It does stop them thinking.
It's time for the Emperor's rest.
The students are right to be angry. I'm angry.
The slogans of the May 4th movement were Mr. Science and Mr. Democracy. And the idea, the prevailing idea amongst intellectuals and nationalists at the time, was that the Confucian past, Chinese tradition, including imperial tradition, irrational, based on religious notions and so on, was really to blame for China's backwardness and weakness. And what was needed was the new scientific Western rationalist approach on the one hand, and democracy on the other. And of course, these ideas came from the West originally, but via Japan very often, mostly, in fact. Now, out of this idealization of science and rationalism, various things could have come. Some form of liberal democracy might have been possible, would certainly be desirable, but in fact, it went in a different direction. It went to the right, where the KMT, the nationalists, General Chiang Kai-shek, became more and more a kind of right-wing, quasi-fascist generalissimo, and it went to the left, represented by the Communist Party and Chairman Mao, who had their own notions of scientific socialism and modern politics and so on. And so, although there were alliances between the KMT and the communists at some periods, they were in effect at loggerheads, and what you got was a long simmering civil war, really, between these two very undemocratic kinds of politics. In the 1920s, the struggle between the nationalists and the communists became increasingly brutal, and although there had been periods of cooperation, in effect, they were fighting for the control of China. And you had Mao, on the one hand, who was not a warlord, but who was mobilizing the peasantry in his native Hunan province, and at the same time purging everybody he saw as an enemy, and there were very many of them. And Mao, certainly, Mao's rise to power as a communist figure was exceedingly brutal. But the nationalists, Chiang Kai-shek's nationalists, could be equally brutal. And in Shanghai, there was a purge of communists, for example, which cost many lives and was quite savage. And so the coming civil war, or the simmering civil war, was not really even simmering anymore in the 1920s. General Chiang Kai-shek embarked on a northern expedition to march his armies to the north of China, really as an attempt to unify China, which was always, of course, his aim, and to a large extent succeeded. Mao was very much in his sort of stronghold in Hunan, and a pattern was set in which the nationalists under Chiang Kai-shek pretty much controlled all the major cities in China, and the only strongholds that the communists had were in the countryside, which the nationalists never really entirely succeeded in controlling. So it was really a civil war very much along the lines that Mao had envisaged and wanted, which was really the revolt, the revolution of the country against the city.
Japan has an emperor. We're almost the same age. I thought it was kindness. At the same time, I realized that for many Chinese, I was an alien, simply because I am Manchurian. There was even an anti-Manchurian league who wanted to assassinate me. So I went to live in Tianjin. It was a nice provincial town with a big port. In those days, they had a large international settlement. The Japanese thought it would be safer for me there.
The Japanese had a policy in this very turbulent period of encouraging various non-Han Chinese aspiring leaders to take the Japanese side. And the people of the Manchu court always dreamed of one day reviving the Qing dynasty. And these were encouraged in these dreams by the Japanese, entirely for Japanese interests, of course. And so the Japanese, who wanted to control Manchuria and eventually set up a puppet state there, but didn't want to do it as colonizers, because one of the part of their ideology was that they were fighting Western imperialists for and to restore the rights of Asian peoples. So what they wanted was a kind of legitimate face to put on their colonial possessions, essentially. And so they saw a chance in taking the young Puyi and nurturing him as a future Manchu ruler over what were in effect Japanese colonial possessions. And this is why from very, very early on, they really wanted to get their claws into him. One of the important Japanese figures in Tianjin at that time was a sinister man called Captain Amakasu, who was the head of all kinds of Manchurian propaganda fronts, including the movie studios, and involved in spying and politics and so on. And so he played a role in nurturing Puyi as the future figurehead of the Japanese puppet state. And then you had a Manchu princess called Eastern Jewel, who was adopted at one point by a Japanese family in Japan. So she was bilingual. She spoke Japanese as well as she spoke Chinese. And her goal was, like Puyi's, was to restore the Manchu dynasty. And she thought that collaborating with the Japanese was the best way to do this. And she had affairs in Shanghai with Japanese secret police officials and so on. And she was rather a pathetic woman in that she, in her way, was a genuine nationalist, but was played like a puppet by the Japanese. In 1931, the Japanese in Manchuria controlled the railway line from Dalian up north. And this was as a result of their war against Russia in 1905, which the Japanese won and added enormously to their prestige, especially in the eyes of Asians who were still under colonial rule. It was the first time that an Asian power had, in modern times, had been victorious against a large Western power. But controlling the railway line was not really enough. They wanted to control more. And so what they did on a winter's night in 1931 was plant a little bomb near what is now the city of Shenyang, then Mukden, and blew up a little bit of the railway line, blamed it on Chinese bandits. And that was an excuse for the Japanese to call in their own troops, the so-called Kwantung Army, or Kantogun, to crack down on the warlord who was still running Manchuria, the Chinese warlord. And the Japanese took over. After 1931, the Japanese effectively controlled Manchuria, which they thought they needed not only as space to live for Japanese, but they wanted to set up heavy industries there, mines, get all their natural resources from there, and saw it as an absolutely vital component not only of the Japanese economy, but also for Japan in a geopolitical sense, that it was a buffer against Russia on the one hand, and communist power, increasing communist power in China. But controlling it as a colony in that period was not really what the Japanese wanted, because it didn't look good. So that's where Puyi comes in. And the coronation in 1934 was symbolic in various ways, not all to the liking of Puyi. On the one hand, the Japanese wanted him to look like a kind of modern tin pot dictator in a military uniform with all kinds of absurd gold braid and boots and peaked caps and so on, which Puyi didn't like. Puyi wanted it to look like a genuine restoration of the Qing dynasty throne. And so he wanted to commune with the gods and wear silk yellow robes and all that. In fact, he got a little bit of both. The Japanese granted him that. But he was never more than a figurehead. The Japanese tried to make this into a very public thing, and there was endless propaganda in Manchukuo through movies, on radio, in various celebrations, parades, jamborees of one kind or another, to make it all look legitimate. But in the eyes of most Chinese, it was never more than a stage show. Of course, most Chinese living in the countryside, in villages, would have been very dimly aware of these politics anyway. In the cities, it was a little bit different. And you did have a class of Chinese businessmen and others who benefited from Japanese rule, because in effect it was Japanese rule, because it was a modernizing force, and they did well out of it, even though they may have been second-class citizens compared to the Japanese. The Japanese did set up schools and universities and so on, and so like all modern colonial enterprises, it was humiliating on the one hand, just as the concessions in Shanghai were humiliating, and an opportunity on the other, so it's not entirely straightforward. Now, Amakasa, who we've already seen in Tianjin, played a very important part in the propaganda because he was the head of the movie studios. And the movies they produced in Chinese were precisely to make it all look legit, with Chinese women falling in love with brave Japanese pioneers and working together for the future of Asia and so on. Now, outside of Manchukuo, inside of Manchukuo, it had very little legitimacy in the eyes of the Chinese, except those who benefited from it. Outside of Manchukuo, it was seen as a total slap in the Chinese face.
Ladies and gentlemen, General Chiang Kai-shek has taken Shanghai. The Kuomintang have broken with the Reds and have knocked them for six.
The Reds are finished. The Reds.
Part of Maoist propaganda is that Chiang Kai-shek and his nationalists never seriously fought the Japanese, that it was only the communists who bravely resisted the fascist invaders. This is not entirely true. In fact, the nationalists engaged in a lot of battles with the Japanese and lost a huge number of lives, whereas it was the communists who tended to dodge and feint and only engaged the Japanese enemy when it was absolutely necessary in guerrilla warfare. It was in their interest to let the nationalists do most of the heavy lifting and hope to take over one day. But it is true that Chiang Kai-shek was ambivalent, and he saw, certainly in the early 30s, the communists as his most important enemy. The Japanese were an enemy to be sure, but the real enemy were the communists, because he always thought that the Japanese would one day be defeated with the help of the Americans and other allies, of course, but he saw them as, that was a short-term problem. The long-term problem for him were the communists. And so he may have been somewhat half-hearted at some points, and maybe even more assiduous in his attempt to crack down on the communists than he was in his efforts to fight the Japanese. There was also talk, and probably there were feelers going back and forth between certain elements of the Japanese government and Chiang Kai-shek to see if some kind of deal could be struck, as both the Japanese and Chiang were opposed to the communists. Now, in 1936, 1937, in that period, the Chinese nationalists, not necessarily just communists, thought that this game had to stop and that a common front had to be established and that Chiang had to be forced to deal with the Japanese as the main enemy. And so he was kidnapped in Xi'an and pretty much forced, put on the spot, and made to agree to form a common front and with the communists and first defeat the Japanese enemy, and then the civil war could wait.
With Manchukuo now firmly in their grasp, the Japanese soon controlled most of North China. By 1937, they were ready to strike south at the heart of the country. The attack on Shanghai was one of the first civilian bombing raids in history. It left thousands homeless, thousands dead.
When the Japanese effectively took over Manchuria in 1931, it was known as the Manchurian Incident. The China Incident happens 6 years later. Of course, it wasn't really an incident, it was an invasion. But the Japanese army had decided to go south. Instead of facing the Soviets directly in the north, those factions in the army who wanted to go south and get at the natural resources of Southeast Asia and control as much as they could of China prevailed, and they went south. They bombed Shanghai, they landed troops on the coast, and they went in from the north towards Beijing. And this led to some of the most brutal battles in World War II. What happened when they landed their troops near Shanghai in 1937 was that they had to fight their way across China to Nanjing, which was the nationalist capital. And they did this village by village, and these were brutalized Japanese troops, brutalized by their own officers often, being slapped around and didn't have enough to eat. And what happened was what happens to many armies faced with guerrillas in unfamiliar countries. They don't know who's the enemy and who isn't. It could be anybody blowing you up with a bomb. It ended, of course, in massacres and in rapes and in atrocities of all kind, culminating in what is known as the Nanking Massacre. And the fight for Nanking, the nationalist capital, was a particularly brutal one. A lot of Japanese lost their lives, and many Chinese too, of course. Chiang Kai-shek took his elite troops out of the capital. They fled before the Japanese got in and left behind a small number of soldiers who couldn't get out, which was not very glorious. And the rich population had also left. So the people left in Nanking when the Japanese finally got through the wall were mostly the poor, those who couldn't escape, and a bunch of soldiers. Now, the Japanese didn't know how to find the soldiers. They didn't know how to distinguish between a civilian and a soldier, so they began to shoot everybody who might have looked like a soldier. And there was there were huge numbers of rapes, there was looting, and so on. Now, why this happened, whether it was ordered by the Japanese high command and or whether it was a case of an army running out of control, whether it was a question of officers allowing their troops to do this as a kind of, to let off steam, as a kind of payoff of a lack of food, of a lack of sleep, of a very brutal existence, we don't really know. Nor do we know exactly how many people were massacred or raped. There are all kinds of figures, but that it was a large number of people is sure. That it was only a climactic moment of similar scenes that had taken place elsewhere is also sure. And what happened then is that the nationalists retreated to Chongqing, as it was known during the war, and established their capital in Sichuan province, further to the south, where they remained. The Japanese never got that far. And so what happened is that the Japanese army controlled cities in various parts of, on the coast, Shanghai and so on, in the north in Beijing. They controlled Nanjing, the old nationalist capital, but they never really controlled the south, Yunnan, Sichuan, and they didn't control many areas in the country, which were often communist strongholds. And so it's not really true to say that the nationalists didn't fight the Japanese. They did, but they decided that the only way to survive was to retreat further south, where the Japanese couldn't come and get them, hoping. And this hope came true, of course, that the Americans would come to their rescue, and they did. And they supplied the Chinese in the south by flying supplies in from Burma. And in the end, helped the Chinese defeat the Japanese from the south and the west, while the Soviets, of course, invaded China in Manchuria. Once the Japanese were defeated in China, the Civil War, of course, started up again with a vengeance. And Chiang Kai-shek tried to get control of China, but he never really succeeded in controlling it beyond the major cities. His regime suffered from many things. I mean, the Japanese had destroyed a great deal of the infrastructure. They'd made sure that Jiang never really had a chance to establish himself as a legitimate force in China and get the economy off the ground. It caused horrendous poverty and hardship. And it had become an extremely corrupt regime with very little legitimacy anymore. And so there weren't enough Chinese really ready to back it anymore. The communists looked better because they'd established themselves through much cleverer propaganda and often by example as the superior patriots. They controlled the countryside in many crucial areas. And then in the north, where all the heavy industry was in Manchukuo, the heavy industry set up often by the Japanese, the Soviets came in and helped the communists in the civil war against the nationalists. The Americans tried to help Jiang, but were limited in what they could do. There was limited enthusiasm. He was too corrupt, often, to support wholeheartedly. So in the end, the countryside, which had been waging a civil war against the city for decades, sort of squeezed the cities further and further, and in the end squeezed the KMT out, the nationalists out, until they had to hightail it to Taiwan in boats. Large numbers of Japanese were arrested and imprisoned by the Soviets in prison camps in Siberia, where many of them didn't survive. Puyi was one of their prisoners, of course a prize catch, and kept in a Soviet camp until the communists took over in China, and he was handed back. And then he was sent to a prison, an old Japanese prison in Fushun in Manchuria, where he was quote-unquote re-educated. And re-education was very much part of communist propaganda, the idea being that they were not going to be simply brutalizing prisoners, they would re-educate them, change their minds, make them into loyal communists. In fact, this was often a form of torture, because if you weren't, in the eyes of your jailers, genuinely re-educated, in other words, if you didn't believe, genuinely believe and demonstrate that you genuinely believed in the propaganda they fed you, you would be tormented even further. The evidence is that he wasn't brutally treated, he wasn't beaten up or anything like that. He simply led a very Spartan existence in this prison and eventually came out saying the only thing he could say to survive in Mao's China, which was that, you know, he changed his mind and this was the legitimate government of China, and he'd do his best as a patriotic Chinese to serve communism. It only made sense for him to say this. Whether he really believed it or not, who knows, but there was no other way he could possibly have survived, and they made it quite comfortable for him to survive. We will never know exactly in numbers how many people were re-educated, how large the prison population was, or indeed still is, in China, just as we will never know the exact number of victims of the Japanese during the Nanking massacre. Many. We certainly know that many millions were murdered in various purges in the 1950s and 60s. We know that at least 30 million people died of famine during the Great Leap Forward. So Puyi was just one very small victim, if you can call him that, of Mao's prison system, and a very privileged one at that. The Great Leap Forward, unleashed by Mao in the 50s, ended up in a terrible disaster. More than 30 million people died of famine. And so he was then forced not to admit his mistake, but he lost a lot of prestige in the eyes of other members of the party. And he felt that his position as the absolute ruler was at least threatened by rivals in the party. And Mao was always very good in playing off rivals against one another, purging them and so on, and making sure that he remained in power. In the late 60s, or middle 60s even, Mao was getting old, and he felt that his position was no longer as secure as the absolute ruler as it should have been in his own eyes. He saw enemies on all sides. Slightly more pragmatic leaders, such as Deng Xiaoping, came to the fore, and he felt that he was being sidelined. And so what he did, in effect, was to stage a coup against his own regime. And he used the students to do this. And he encouraged students to rebel against their teachers, against their professors. He encouraged the Red Guards and said he was one of them. And he appeared on Tiananmen Square in a Red Guards uniform and said, "I'm one of you." And he encouraged everybody to rebel against their fathers, against the local political leaders, against the bureaucracy, against the professors, and so on. Massive purges against anything that was associated with the establishment. And these purges were violent and horrible in many cases, and caused the deaths of many and so forth. And so what he did is he plunged the country into a situation of total chaos, in order for himself to emerge again as the absolute ruler with no rivals, and succeeded for a short while.